So in the last video, we built this D latch, which has the enable input as well as the D input. And whenever the enable input is high, then the output here, the Q output, is just equal to whatever the D input is. And then there's also an inverted Q output, or a complementary or negative Q output, that's always just the opposite of what Q is. And then if the enable is not high, then it doesn't matter what happens with the D input. So this is the D latch. I've made a slight modification from the circuit we had in the last video, which is that on the inputs I've added these LEDs. And so if we're not pushing the button, then this is going to be very close to 0 volts. It'll sink a little bit of a current through the LED, but not enough to light the LED up. And then when we push the button, then we're connecting 5 volts to the input. And so the input goes from 0 volts to 5 volts. And then we also have 5 volts that can flow through the LED, and this resistor just limits the current through the LED so we don't burn up the LED. And so I just added these LEDs so that we can see what the inputs are. So to get a better sense of how this works, we can look at a timing diagram, which is this here, which shows the values of the inputs, the enable input and the D input, over time. And so it shows them going high and low, and we can see, we can kind of think through what's going to happen to the Q output. And I've left off the inverted Q output because I think it's just kind of distracting, but in fact I'll remove this LED. But you know, just keep in mind that the D latch also has an inverted output that's just always going to be the opposite of whatever Q is. So remember, the way this works is whenever the enable input is high, the Q output is just going to follow whatever the D input is. So just for these periods of time where the enable is high, the Q is just going to be what the D is. So the Q here is going to be just what the D input is. And then the rest of the time, when the Q, when the enable is low, the Q output is just going to stay whatever it is. So if it starts out off, for example, it's just going to stay off. Here it's off, and so it's just going to stay off. And then here it's just going to stay off. And in this case, it's going to stay on, and in this case, it'll stay off. So it doesn't matter, you know, during these periods what the enable or what the D input is doing. As long as the enable is off, it's just going to stay latched wherever it is. So if we want, we can just verify that this works the way that we think it should. Yeah, and it looks like it works the way we would expect. So that's great, and hopefully it makes sense to you how that works. But oftentimes in more complex digital logic circuits, we've got lots and lots of different latches that are latching different values all over the place. And it's important to keep all of that in sync. And so typically there is a clock of some sort that is controlling the operation of all of the different components and keeping everything synchronized. And it's important, what you want is you want to be able to latch the values at a particular point in that clock cycle, not necessarily just transparently passing through the values anytime that clock signal is on. And so to do this, we'll look at a variation of the latch, which is a flip-flop. So with the D latch, anytime it's enabled, the input D is going to be output at Q. And so if the D input changes while the latch is enabled, then you'll see a change at the output. But oftentimes what's more useful is to think of instead of having an enable input, having a clock input, and then only outputting a change at that, just at the point where the clock transitions from low to high. And so this clock is really more of kind of a heartbeat that says at these specific points in time, that's when I want the latch to latch in or change its value. And so, for example, at this point here where the latch transitions from low to high, that means we want to take this value right here at D, and we want that as our output. So that's a high output. So if we were already low, then we would transition to high at that point there. And then we want to not do anything. So even though the D input changes while the clock is still high, we don't care. All we care about is when the next clock pulse is, which is the next pulse from low to high. And then we want to take this value. And that happens to be high, and so in this case, the latch won't switch. And so it'll stay high here. And then we say we don't care about anything that happens, you know, even though it goes low and this is still high here, we don't do anything because all we're doing is we're looking for that next transition from low to high, that next clock pulse. And that happens here where D is low. And so at that point in time, we'll switch the latch off. And then again, we don't care what happens here, you know, it goes high again, whatever, we don't care. We're looking for that next clock pulse where it goes from low to high. And in that case, the D input is high, and so at that time, we will switch the latch back on. And in this case, there's no more transition, so we just stay high. And so you'll notice this is a very different output than we got with this scenario where we're using the enable. But it turns out this is actually far more common. It's far more common to want to only switch at a particular instant in time. So the question is, how do we build a circuit that does this? Well, one way would be is if we could build a circuit that could take this clock input and turn it into essentially something that would be useful as an enable input for normal D latch. So to kind of give an example of what I'm talking about there is, you know, imagine we could take this clock signal and get a signal out, you know, put it into some circuit, and then get a signal out that had these really quick pulses just at this point where the clock transitions from low to high. So if we could build a circuit that could do this, then we could use this new signal here at the top as an enable for just the classic D-latch that we've been looking at so far. And as long as this pulse is really, really narrow, then effectively we're getting an instantaneous, or as close to instantaneous as we can, kind of readout of what D is and transitioning just at that point. And so if you look at this, this is kind of like your enable in a regular D-latch. And then if you have that enable and that D, you put that into a regular D latch, then this is the output you'll get. And hopefully that makes sense. And so you can see if we could somehow take this clock signal and detect these rising edges with a circuit that we'll call an edge detector, and detect those edges and then turn that into a pulse like this, then we can build what's called a D flip-flop, which is a circuit that will take, you know, that will start with this clock and only transition at these points where the clock transitions from low to high. So now the question is, how can we build an edge detector circuit that, you know, takes this clock signal and outputs these pulses? Well, there's a couple ways to do it. And one is this sort of interesting looking circuit here. And you might be wondering, well, you know, what does this do? We've got one input and one output. And so, you know, the idea is that somehow a rising edge here is gonna result in a pulse over here. But you might be wondering, well, we've got this inverter going into an AND gate, and so we have an input here going through an inverter, and you know, one side's going through the inverter, the other side isn't. So if you had, you know, let's say you had a zero over here, well, that zero, you know, if you have a zero coming in, it's a zero over here, it's going to be a one over here. And then, you know, the AND gate's going to be a zero. It's, you know, it's only going to be a one if both inputs are ones. And you might wonder, well, how do you get to both inputs being one? I mean, if this is a zero, then this is going to be a one. If this is a one, then this is going to be a zero because we're inverting this. And so this, you would think this AND gate would never turn on. And you'd almost be right. But what happens is if this signal is a zero, you know, we have this situation here where we have a zero coming in and a one here. And so the AND gate's going to be off. We're going to have a zero coming out. But when this input transitions from a zero to a one, this, instead of being a zero, is going to be a one. And then you would say, well, then this would be a zero because we're inverting. But the inverter actually takes a small amount of time to switch states. So when this input changes from zero to one, we've got a one here immediately, but the inverter doesn't switch off for, you know, a few nanoseconds, you know, a very short amount of time, but enough time that for a very brief period of time, we've got a one and a one coming into this AND gate, which turns the AND gate on. But then, of course, very quickly, the inverter switches off. This one turns to a zero, and now we've got a one and a zero. And then, of course, the AND gate turns off. And so it turns off almost immediately. But now we have this pulse, and we get this pulse anytime this input transitions from low to high, we'll get a little pulse that comes out. And that's exactly what we wanted here in order to detect this rising edge on this clock signal. So that's one way of building an edge detector. And I would actually encourage you to try building this yourself. There's a simpler way though that I'm going to do, because you know this is going to require an AND gate and an inverter, potentially multiple inverters. You might find if you try to build this, you need to stack up three or five of these inverters in a row just to get enough of a delay so that you get a big enough pulse. But you know, you can give it a try. But a much easier way to do it that doesn't require adding more chips here is to use a resistor and a capacitor. And so we can use a little circuit like this, where we go into a capacitor, and then, you know, through that capacitor, and then we have a resistor here that goes to ground. And so you're wondering, well, what does this do? Well, in this case, if you've got this signal that comes in that transitions from low to high like this, when it's at zero, we've got, you know, 0 volts across this capacitor. The capacitor is discharged, you know, because the ground here is going to be at zero. So, you know, you've got 0 volts over here. So that's not very exciting. But then when it turns on, the capacitor is going to start to charge. And as it charges, there's current flowing into it. And of course, if you've got current flowing through here, you're going to have a higher voltage here across this resistor. And so as soon as this turns on, this is going to jump up to 5 volts. You know, assuming this is a 5-volt transition here. But very quickly, that capacitor is going to charge, and it's going to charge through this resistor. And as the capacitor charges, less and less current is going to flow into it until the capacitor becomes fully charged. And when the capacitor is fully charged, then no current is going to flow through here, and we're going to be back down at zero. And so what happens is this turns on very quickly, and then it slowly, or maybe not so slowly, depending on how fast this is, but it discharges, or excuse me, it charges, the capacitor charges, and so the voltage over here drops until, you know, once the capacitor is fully charged, you can have 5 volts on this side, 0 volts on this side, no current flows. And so you can see this is a pretty simple circuit to take, you know, this rising edge and turn it into a quick pulse, you know, because then this can stay high and this will just be low. But you get this nice quick pulse right at that rising edge, which is what we want. So the question is, how quick is this pulse? And you know, I'm not going to go into deriving all of the math, but you can calculate the width of this pulse by just multiplying the value of the capacitor and the resistor. If you multiply the value of the capacitor and resistor, it'll tell you essentially where, you know, the point or how much time it'll take for this capacitor to get about 2/3 of the way charged, which will give you a pretty good sense of how short this gap is. So let's build this. I've got a resistor and a capacitor here. This is a 0.1 microfarad capacitor. And then this is a 1K resistor. And so if we want to figure out this time constant, to figure out how big this pulse is, we can just multiply these together. But of course, we've got to get them into standard, you know, farads and ohms. So 0.1 microfarads is going to be 0.1 times 10 to the minus 6. And then 1K, of course, is just 10 to the third. And so if we take 0.1 times 10 to the minus 6, multiply that by 10 to the third, we get 0.1 times 10 to the minus third, which is going to be equal to 0.1 milliseconds. Because if you're multiplying farads times kilo-ohms in this sort of circuit, you end up with seconds. And so 0.1 milliseconds is how long this gap will be. So for our purposes, we can say that, you know, okay, 0.1 milliseconds is, you know, pretty much instantaneous, which is what we're going for here. We're looking for, you know, when this clock transitions, we just sort of take an instantaneous read of this D input. So as long as in our circuit, this D isn't transitioning anywhere near, you know, every 0.1 milliseconds, then we'll be fine. And of course, in this case, we've got a button here. I'm not pushing it any faster than that, so we'll be fine. So let's go ahead and build this. So right now, I've just got this little jumper here between the enable button and the, you know, enable part of the circuit. So I'm going to take that jumper out, and instead, we will put this capacitor in. So that's this capacitor. So from the button, we're going to get this pulse, and then of course we need this 1K resistor here going to ground, so for the capacitor to charge through. So let's give it a try and see if it works the way we would expect. And it looks like it works just the way that we would expect it to, which is great. And you know, definitely different than the D latch. And so that's the D flip-flop. And if you look at the D flip-flop, it's basically very similar to the D latch. In fact, it's identical, except that instead of the enable, you have some sort of pulse detector. And in this case, I'm using a resistor and a capacitor. You could use this, you know, this weird AND gate inverter thing if you wanted to, but something that's going to detect a pulse for that clock pulse. And so instead of having an enable input and a D input, you have a clock input and a D input. And in the sort of block diagram for that, the clock input is usually indicated with a little triangle here that tells you, that this is edge triggered. And so that's the D flip-flop, and that's probably the most common way of storing data in a digital logic circuit.